أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله أحمده وأستعينه وأستغفره نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها فإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. I praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and He's the only one worthy of praise. I seek His help, His guidance and His forgiveness. I believe in Him and I trust Him. I seek refuge in Almighty Allah from the evil of our passions. Indeed, whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides him to al-Islam, no one can mislead him after Allah. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him astray, no one can guide him after Allah. I testify openly that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah Rabbil Alameen. And I testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger and the seal of all the prophets. O Muslims, you must know that the best speech is the speech of Almighty Allah, which is the Quran. The best guidance is the course of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is his sunnah. The worst of all affairs is innovation and addition to the religion of Islam. Indeed, every addition to the religion of Islam will lead to hellfire. I adjure you as well as myself to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best of your ability. Have the taqwa of Allah and don't die unless you are in a state of Islam. Before I start my khutbah today, from my place here, I'd like to send a special greeting to one of the brothers. I'm sorry I didn't have camera with me to take his picture, to put it someplace on the internet, to show the people the real sunnah, and the real love, and the real kindness. But my eyes saw it. And I had a smile in my heart, before in my face. While I'm coming out of my car, I saw one of the brothers, he bent down in the middle of the parking lot, helping his wife to tie her shoes. May Allah bless you. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all, that we know the real sunnah and the true Islam, and that we put it in action. A special greeting, and I'm not going to say the brother name, not to be any embarrassment or putting somebody on the spot. But what you did, brother, I'm sure you didn't learn it from anybody other than the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Right away, my mind went so fast and quick, and I start to look to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he sat down beside his camel and he bent his knee and he made his thigh as a footstool for his wife to be able to come and ride the camel. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the proper practice of our deen. As for today, I have a verse, selected verse for myself, as well as my brothers and sisters, and in Surah Al-Anfal. ذلك بأن الله لم يكن مغيرا نعمة أنعمها على قوم حتى يغيروا ما بأنفسهم وأن الله سميع عليم. This Surah Al-Anfal, the spoils of the war, this Surah number 8 and verse number 53. Allah the Almighty is saying what the meaning is. That is so because Allah will never change a grace which He has bestowed on a people until they change what is in their own selves. And verily Allah is well hearer, all knower. What this verse is saying? Allah has a lot of ni'mah. Allah has a lot of graces. Allah has a lot of bounties. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most generous, the most generous one. And Allah is bestowing a lot of blessings and a lot of favors on mankind, right and left. And He told us, if we count the favor of Allah, we never can number them. Sometimes that we need to clean our eyeglasses. Sometimes that we need to rub our eyes. Sometimes that we need to open our eyes to see. But whosoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't give him a sight, doesn't give him a light, no one can give him a sight or no one can give him a light to see. And when these favors and the blessings of Allah comes right and left, from the front, from the back, from above you and beneath you, every direction, it will remain there. Unless you, and you as a single, or you as a duo, or you as a family, or you as a community, or you as a society and government or kingdom. That Allah is not going to change it unless you change. So if you want to keep the favor of Allah, the blessing of Allah continuing showering you, do not step down, do not divert from Sirat al-Mustaqim, do not stop practicing Islam or please with Islam with the minimum, because it shows that you are ungrateful, because Allah had made real insurance, not a fake insurance. All this insurance you hear about is nothing but fake, giving you some money when something happened. But they could not give you death insurance, life insurance, could not give you your life, could not give you your dad when it died. Is nothing but a fake, not real names. The real insurance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it and said it in Quran, that when you be grateful and thankful, that Allah will increase and give more. Allah will give more. But when you try to be ungrateful or being unfaithful or unbeliever, non-believer, now Allah will take it. Will take it away from you. You start. You're the one who makes the change. And the reactions comes as a result of the change. I'm saying this again, my brothers, to tie this khutbah to the khutbah that I stated last week. I'm telling you and I'm reminding you again and again. I'm a warner to you. And I'm telling you, if you are not going to take advantage of the blessings that Allah had given you, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is capable to withdraw it away from you because you don't deserve it. And I'm saying to you Muslims, doesn't matter if you're young or old, doesn't matter if you're male or female, those Muslims who live in US, doesn't matter you are citizen, green card, or that you came from overseas, whatever, or you're born and raised here, you have something good available in this country that is not even available in the best so-called Islamic country. And I mean it. If you are not going to take advantage of it, the big possibility that Allah will withdraw it from you. Don't think always negative about everybody or every society and every people. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam even taught us this with the closest companion to us. And he told us, لا يفرق مؤمن مؤمنا, that a believer is not to hate his wife. Because if you displease with something with her in her, رضي منها خلقا آخر, there is no 100% bad wife. And if you think your wife is 100% bad and wrong, this is because you 100% negative. You could not see any good in her. And if any wife thinks that her husband is the worst and he is nothing for nothing, that because she's blind, there is something there. But especially a husband, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you could not hate your wife. If you displease with something in her, there is something else that you would like in her. Maybe she is not the best in cleaning in the house, but what about the food? Maybe it's not the best cooker, but what about taking care of the children? Find something to take this hatred negativity away. So we are not saying and condemning everything. We say there is a lot of bad here, and also there is a lot of bad overseas. But I'm telling you, one of the ni'mah, one of the blessings that we are been enjoying here in this country. And again I say, it doesn't matter who you are. If you are here for 5 years, 6 years, 10 years, get your degree and leave, you better use the blessings that Allah had showered you in this country. You never know. Wallahi, it doesn't matter. Even if they write democracy everywhere in all the wars, something will come and will be excused to withdraw this blessing from you. But it's not because they want to take it, because they did not appreciate it, because they did not utilize it when we have it. I'm saying to you Muslims, you have the golden opportunity that you do not have it even in the best Islamic countries that exist on the earth. I don't know which country that you call it the best, Arab or Islamic country. You have a freedom here. You have a freedom here that you can give da'wah, that you can walk in the street, distribute flyers about Islam, that you can publish books, you can distribute CDs, you can open a mosque. And there is negativity and positive things about, yes, the given green light, $150 by a document of corporation, you open a mosque. You can be president of any company, any church, anything. Yes, but there is good side and there is bad side. Look to the good side. You've been given the opportunity to do a lot, but as you don't want to appreciate ذَلِكَ. That because Allah never take away a grace, a blessing that He gives to the people, unless they themselves, they've been ungrateful. Being ungrateful. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us about being ungrateful is a form of kufr. When he told the women in the Eid, تصدقنا, لأني رأيتكن أكثر أهل النار. قلنا لماذا يا رسول الله؟ قال لأنكن تكفرن. كنا نكفر بالله؟ قال تكفرن العشير. So this is the type of kufr. The Prophet said to the woman, give in charity. Because I saw you, the most dwellers of hellfire. Say, why, O Prophet of Allah? Say, because you disbelieve. Say, disbelieve in Allah? Say, no. Being ungrateful to your husband. This is a form of disbelief. So when you did not utilize the ni'mah, you showing, you are not showing gratitude to Allah, you are not using it, you are not taking advantage of it, you are a disbeliever in a form. And be ready that Allah will take it away from you. That Allah will take it from you. Doesn't matter. Say, brother, this is democracy here. Yes. But when you have this democracy and you have the freedom of speech and you have freedom of publishing and giving your opinion and you did not utilize it. Why Muslims are not coming to the mosque? Why the Muslim did not show up for classes? Why Muslims are not getting together to do something for the Muslims or for the non-Muslims? Why some Muslims, it got to the extreme? Why? You're supposed to be sensible person. You're supposed to be adult. Some of you already in my age. Most of you in 40s. And maybe few of you can say 60, 65, 70, you in my age. But you are not acting according to your age. This is a problem. And take it or leave it. Because you are not acting wise. You are not using the ni'mah that Allah gave it to you. Your focus, main focus about making Salat al-Jum'ah, the 5-time prayers in the office, in the house, as he said, this is the whole connection between you and the mosque or your deen. Other than this, no participation. Don't tell me no. I'm not judging you, but you know I'm here in this house every day. I don't have a weekend. You know that I'm here more than I am in my house. So I can tell you how many people taking advantage of this mosque. What are you doing for Islam? When you come here, especially this youth, Shabab, Allah giving them ni'mah. Check coming every year, every month. They have nothing to do except to study. Study language, okay? This is all what required from you. And after this, you go to college. And after this, what? What? Why you are not doing something for your deen? Why we have to go to the extreme? You found especially the young people, they go to the extreme. They go extreme that they go carry machine guns and fighting. Fighting what? Who you fighting? Who you fighting? Who you killing? What gave you justification to kill? Muslim or non-Muslim today? Give me from Quran or Sunnah. Show me. We go to the extreme. That we, the only thing we jump when we really somebody telling us military stuff and drive to fight and jihad and this and that, everybody ready to go. Or that we go to the other extreme, we doing nothing. We doing nothing. Brother, what are you talking about? Every week I'm putting $50, $10, $5 in the charity box. Thank you. Brother, I come here for every Juma. Thank you. Brothers, is deen is not a teen. Is deen is not teen. You understand? It is a whole system of life. And if we are not going to use this time that Allah bless us to be in America, to organize ourselves, to unite ourselves, to care for one another, to help one another, to give da'wah, to do something, when we're going to do it? When you go back home, they will put you in jail because you have a beard. They put you in jail because three people working together. Look, 50 people, 100 people, 100 people upstairs. Look, who do I have? Talking in microphone, calling azan by the speaker. Do you think you can do this? Do you know what happened 2 weeks ago? I don't want to name country because some people are so sensitive. Say, waiting. I'm only naming countries so you know what I'm saying is right. But in a country, Muslim country, population or majority, 96% Muslims, the head of Islamic Institute there, he had made the law to close all the schools that memorize Quran and teach Quran. It's an order. And because what? Because it promotes terrorism. These kids, when they memorize Quran, learn the Quran, this makes them... Come on, please. Do you know about any place here been closed in the United States because they memorize Quran? Did you hear about a mosque been closed in the United States of America that because they have a khatib? Or because... Did you hear about any? So, when you're going to take advantage of this opportunity? When you're going to be grateful? Otherwise, you say to Allah, I'm not doing anything about it, so now is your time, Allah. You can take it away from me. Because some people, they don't care. America give it to you or doesn't give it to you, I'll go make Jum'ah and they say it. Okay? It's between you and Allah. But don't cry later on. Today, you have opportunity. Later on, when it's taken away, you're going to feel sad. When we look to the place like other countries, they claim democracy, but they forbid women to wear hijab. Like in France, as example, okay? Or they don't go to special buildings wearing hijab, because this is government building, and we did not enter your personal freedom, but this is our place, you could not come here with hijab. Do you know a woman that been forbidden to walk in the street in hijab? Do you know any Muslim sister that she have to take her hijab because she gone in her job with her hijab? Do you know about any people want to make a conference, Islamic conference? They are not going to camouflage it and put it social and no, the Islamic conference. And they said, no, you could not. So why are you not taking advantage of it? Why are you not coming to the mosque? I want to, time going fast, and I don't want to do the same mistake again, run out of time and delay you. I want to tell you one thing, because like I told you, I learned a lot through my last experience being in the hospital. And I'm telling you, I'm 65 plus now. And I'm telling you, if I'm going to be with you for a day or a week or a month or a year, if Allah extend my life, I would like to pass some of my experience to you so you can take care of the mosque, so you can help. Don't think when Muhammad Adli is dead, now you're going to jump, you know, I'm going to, oh, I'm an imam brother, I'm going to give the khutbah. Wallahi, some brothers been 8 years or 10 years Muslims, I ask him to call the adhan. He doesn't know how to say it. He doesn't know how to say it. Even a brother coming from Islamic country, we need training about everything. We don't have military training here, okay? We don't have any of this, all right? We have training. The Prophet trained the Sahaba. And one day about to enter the Salah, I say, Allahu Akbar, and you look, he found somebody sticking out. Say, stawu, itadilu. The Prophet teaches him how to stand in the prayer. Shoulder to shoulder, foot to foot, straight in the line. He taught them how to sit in the mosque on Friday. Until now, I see faces that I saw them 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. They don't know what to sit in the mosque when they come to Jummah. Because we don't have the discipline. We may have the knowledge, but the discipline is not there. Nobody can tell you, I am a man, I'm married, I have 5 kids. Where you are to talk to me? Yes, I'm going to talk to you. Take it or leave it. Okay? You will get enough break from me sooner, inshallah. But while I'm alive, I'm going to let you hear it. Take it or leave it. But this is what we are here. وَتَوَاسَوْ بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاسَوْ بِالصَّبْرِ. They're talking about something called legacy or something like this. I want to tell you very quick, brothers. It's already 2 o'clock. I didn't talk yet. What you call about legacy, okay? I want to tell you what I left behind before I die. And what you need to be aware about it. So you can stand when Muhammad Adli dropped dead, that you're ready to keep it going on. Alhamdulillah, since 1980, everybody know about this mosque, okay? the outside and the inside. We don't have any military training here. We don't have jihad here. We don't have this, understand? Okay? But we have classes here. We have a discipline here. We have a school here. We have things, understand, which are permitted to other religious organizations. We're doing the same. Okay? So, I'm leaving behind me. Not that I'm saying that I owe this mosque, but Allah bless me to be the seed and the beginning before the mosque to be in this area. And Allah bless me to be a cause for people to get together and we have a mosque. And I want to tell you very quick and fast, Yom al-Jum'ah. Only if I take Yom al-Jum'ah. Look, brothers, I'm carrying this, I'm carrying this, I'm carrying this, I'm carrying this. Where is the committees? Where is the committees that are in this mosque? Show me one single committee in the whole mosque for the last 5-10 years. Do you know what, brothers? Last week, a brother that was dead. We're supposed to go to wash the body. And one brother could not make it. The second brother could not make it. The third brother could not make it. So sad. What do we have? We have a building. I have a charity box, so what? In Yawm al-Jum'ah, why nobody can come and sit with me for 10 minutes to know what I'm doing? How to turn it, how to start it, how to publish it, how to do something? What? Everybody, every one of you have a big degree. But what you doing? Selfishness, nothing. Your degree helping you. You are not helping the Islamic cause in anything. Except a little, few dollars here and you can make Jum'ah. I told you. So, let's talk about Yom al-Jum'ah, the cleaning up, the organization, the food. And by the way, the food that cook and sold outside is not for the imam, it's not for them. We'll try to help the children for the school. All right? Who cooking? Who's cooking? The imam's wife or the imam's family. Who's making the juice? Who's carrying the iced tea? Who? You understand? Oh, brother, why is $5? Why is $7? We don't, wallahi, we don't put a dime in our. We spend on it, you understand, for the school. Yawm al-Jum'ah is a big job. Where is the community? Where is your participation? Let's talk as example. Preparing the speakers, preparing for the lecture, recording the khutbah, publishing the khutbah, so somebody else can benefit from it, okay? Selling the food, okay? My family going for Umrah, so now we're closing. Closing the stand outside. Why? Why only my family? Why nobody can do something? It's not for me. I don't need your money. I don't need my possession. I don't need anything from you. I'm here for you. But I'm limited, guys. And I'm leaving soon. I'm telling you. You need to stand up and get some kind of a training and discipline and know how to handle things. We have the weekend Islamic school. How many people helping in the Islamic school? We have a full-time school. How many people helping in the full-time school? Where is the committees? Do you know any committees? Any kind of committees? Go to any church. Go to any church. I'm going as example next month to Connecticut. They preparing the communication between me for the lectures. So this is the committee. They're going to prepare a slideshow and everybody. I said, wow, why we don't have this stuff? You think because we don't know? No, because we don't care. Because we're so selfish. Hey, if it doesn't fit you, don't wear it. If it fits you, wear it. So don't say I'm pointing finger to you. But if you are not doing it, so it fits you, you need to hear it. We're about to start food bank. I've been working about this project, me and one sister, for the last 6 months. It's about to start. What is the people going to help? We try to help the society, help the non-Muslims and the Muslims. What is the people? How many of you show up? You understand? We don't know about it. I want to tell you about, I have about 7 property, not mine. I don't have a house that I owe until today, 40 years in America. But I have about 7 property at least under the AGRIB application. If I drop dead tomorrow, who's going to manage it? Who's going to manage it? This is for a Islamic cause. we help and shelter Muslims who are homeless or have little income. Seven properties. By Allah's will, I sweat, I work hard. I have seven properties. Where is the Muslim? Anybody know about it? Anybody going to help? Anybody going to try to look over, look after it when I die? Where? Okay. I have about 5,000 tapes, still audio tapes, need to be transferred to another format that can be uploaded to the internet so Muslims can benefit from it. Where is the Muslims? I have about almost 30 booklets, and I'm sure you're aware about it. If a booklet finish and the people need it more, okay, who's going to do this? Anybody care? All right. I have Adli online. I have MuhammadAdli.com. I have other internet sites. Who's going to manage? Who's going to look after it? All these things is going to disappear because one person? I'm telling you, come and take your spot. Come and take care of responsibility promoting the da'wah. Who? How these things can go dead because one person died? Oh, brother, you're doing everything by yourself. I don't know anything about you. No, you know. You know, okay? You know. Do not. Do not. Allah knows. Who's going to take care of these things? I have other books that's supposed to be published, and it's not yet. I have a lot of things. Nothing but about da'wah. Where is the Muslims? What's going to happen to the property when I die? Anybody? I have organizations that, by the will of Allah, been started about 20 years ago called CIC, organized the imams of North and South America, North and South Carolina, and is still going, and we meet four times every year, promoting da'wah, learning from the other imam, visit other masajid, and you saw some of it. Who's going to be making sure that CIC continues when Muhammad Adli died? Why? Why all this work of 40 years have to go under the dirt? A human being can go under the dirt. Imam al-Bukhari under the dirt. Everybody want to understand, but look, we still have the books of Imam al-Bukhari. Everybody knows Imam al-Bukhari. I'm not saying I'm Imam al-Bukhari, but I'm saying at least I put something in English, a book that they can give it to somebody to tell them about Islam. You brothers, you have to know, sisters, you have to know there is a lot we can do when we get together, when we donate some of our time. All of you smart, all of you have degrees, all of you have money, all of you have and have and have. But how much you try to bring so we can put it together? When the Sahaba used to be starving, they have nothing, the Prophet said to them, bring what is a little bit of food and left over together. And he bring it together and say, sit and eat together. Everybody happy and satisfied. Everybody's full. Our problem, individualism, that we don't care. When we want to change, I don't know. But I'm telling you, remember in Surah Al-Anfal, Surah number 8, verse number 54, that when Allah take a grace from somebody, take ni'mah, don't blame anybody except your own self. الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بادروا بالأعمال فتنا كقطع الليل المظلم يصبح الرجل مؤمنا ويمسي كافرا ويصبح كافرا ويمسي كافرا ويمسي كافرا ويمسي مؤمنا يصبح الرجل مؤمنا ويمسي كافرا ويمسي مؤمنا ويصبح كافرا يبيع دينه بعرض من الدنيا. The prophet say rush, not drag your feet, rush with good deed before trials and temptation and corruption became so much, became so like darkness of the night you could not see. It's time, brothers. It's time, sisters. It's a lot of fitan. It's a lot of trials. is a lot of temptation going on everywhere. In America and overseas, everywhere. And the Prophet said, rush with the good deed before the fitan will come. Because this fitan is going to affect you. Don't think you are a superman or a super believer. And say, a man by the morning he's a believer, by night he's what? He's a disbeliever. By the night he's a believer, by the morning he's what? Disbeliever. Why? He said he will exchange his deen because part of this material thing. Because a dunya. Because a degree, because some dollars, because position, because a name for home game. Okay? So remember, the Prophet is saying, Badiru, hurry up, rush with good deeds before trials already in. But still, we can do something. Brothers, sisters, the blessings that Allah blessed, especially this mosque, that we open in room for anybody who trying to help. Trying to help. We have people been trained to give the khutbah. We have people been trained to try to give the adhan. We have people trained, you understand, to take care of that weekend Islamic school. This a lot can be done, but I could not make miracles. So please, for the sake of Allah, try to do something for the Muslims, and they try to be a means to give da'wah. And remember, ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. In the day of judgment, you'll be questioned about all the blessings. And I'm telling you, one of the blessings that Allah give you, that you have freedom in this country, that you can give da'wah, that you can do a lot of Islamic activity that is not available back home, and you better take advantage of it before it's taken away from you. I beg Allah's forgiveness for me and you and all the Muslims. Amen. I pray that Allah makes these words beneficial for the speaker and those who had heard this. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
استووا اعتدلوا تراصوا استووا الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
آمين.
قل هو الله أحد، الله الصمد، لم يلد ولم يولد، ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Thank you.
Others are praying, others are praying, it's loud.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As you know, the time changed last Sunday, so today inshallah will be start for Quran memorization between Salat al-Maghrib and Isha. And Isha prayer will be at 9:30 inshallah ta'ala. 9:30, Salat al-Isha. Isha prayer will be 9:30 inshallah.
Only for tonight.
Only for tonight. Only for tonight. كما تعلمون يا أخوتي إن الوقت تغير من الأحد الماضي ولدينا برنامج تحفيظ القرآن لهذه الليلة إن شاء الله تعالى وصلاة العشاء ستكون عند الساعة 9:30 فقط هذه الليلة بعدين سننظر إن شاء الله ماذا سيجري في الجمعة القادمة بعون الله تعالى السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
الحمد لله